The following podcast is part of the Underdog Sports Podcast Network. For advertising information or to find more great podcasts, visit us at www.theunderdogsports.com and follow us on Twitter at RealTheUnderdog.
Okay, well, just for the record, we got the sun in Phoenix too.
52 to...
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Sunny in Phoenix podcast, a weekly podcast where we keep you up to date on everything Phoenix Suns basketball. My name is Charlie Erling, and we've got Mitch Krumpetich in the house.
Hello, everyone. We also have a special guest today. Please welcome to the Sunny in Phoenix podcast, Keith, a.k.a. at Sundress Dunks on Twitter. How you doing, Keith?
Hey, I'm doing great. How are you?
Good, good. We're so happy to have you. Sundress Dunks Keith is a very active Twitter participant, so we were really happy to have him. We're going to have him do some trivia today. That's going to be our episode. So despite all of the wild things that are going on in our world right now, we're still going to be putting out podcasts, and so we're doing some trivia with Keith today. But before we get started with that, I'm just curious, Keith, how did you become a Suns fan? What made you fall in love with this team?
Well, I grew up in a small town in West Virginia where there were no basketball teams. And in the 80s, I was watching KJ and the Run and Gun Suns. And they were just so fun to watch. And, you know, I loved basketball. And so I just fell in love with the Suns. And actually, it's one of the happiest days of my life because Charles Barkley was my favorite player. And then he got traded to the Suns. And so it's really been a love affair since then.
Oh, that's awesome. That's hey, so funny. That's both of our stories, too.
It's really cool. States. It's different states, and it goes by a different generation of Suns basketball.
Yeah.
Because I got in later on in the Barkley years, towards the end of it, and then you got in on the 7 seconds or less Suns, correct, Mitch?
Right, yeah. I mean, so I grew up in Wyoming, and I got in on, like, the, 05, 06, maybe a little bit earlier than that, but, like, the Nash, Marion, Stoudemire days. That's so funny. It's, like, the exact same story as what we have.
That's great. I wonder if the Suns really bring in a lot of fans like that. I wonder if there's just guys like us speckled across the United States. You got to assume there are.
I would think so.
Yeah, and then all those Australian fans and overseas fans. So.
Right, right. Yeah, that's a good point, too. We have quite a few of those, including our other Twitter friend, at Comic Evangelist. If you're interested in coming on the show like this, hit us up, because, you know, it's pretty fun so far. So, yeah, Keith, anything that you want to plug before we get started?
No, I just thank you guys for this pleasant diversion from everything going on right now.
Absolutely. Yeah, we're happy to have you. And then really quick, before we get started with explaining how the trivia is going to work, we're going to check in on just where the NBA is at right now.
Follow us on Twitter at SunnyandPHXPod. Same thing for Instagram. Go on iTunes. Leave us a 5-star review and a comment, and you will get a shout out on the show.
And we have an iTunes review that we need to shout out. If you go on iTunes, leave us a 5-star review and a review where you actually write it, you'll get a shout out. So shout out to Duh Knees, who says, this is going to be fun to read. Rickster or Rufio. I don't know which name is the best, but what I do know is that this is one heckin' pod. This is my go-to for all things Suns, and both Mitch and Chuck do an awesome job, especially like the non-sports section. Keep it up. Go Suns. So thank you so much. One of our funniest reviews, I would say.
Agreed.
So due to the coronavirus and all of this, players do not have access to team facilities anymore. They're being told to stay at home. So unfortunately, they can only train in their multi-million dollar homes with their personal courts. So this could be really tough for them. I'm being sarcastic, obviously. But still, no access to team facilities. They're not practicing together. As of right now, the NBA is aiming for a June or July return, but this is uncertain. They're evaluating on pretty much a day-by-day basis, just like everyone else in the world is. But as of right now, the latest information we have is that they're aiming for a June or July return. We still don't know if this will include regular season games or playoffs, but, you know, keep your eyes on Twitter, and Woj is putting out a ton of information. So, you know, day-by-day basis, basically, with this. But that's all we have for this. We're going to try to avoid talking about everything that's going on in the world right now and just talk about the Suns. So the way this is going to work, we have some trivia questions here. Charlie and I have access to the answers and everything, but Keith doesn't. We are going to just trust him that he's not going to Google these or anything like that. I have trust that he won't. So 10 questions, multiple choice. If, you know, if we have time, maybe we'll get into a few more. But we have these 10 questions. There's also 3 lifelines. So they're all multiple choice. Each one of them has 4 options. Our lifelines are number 1, eliminate 1 wrong answer. Number 2, eliminate 2 wrong answers. And number 3 is just a straight up hint. So the other thing we're going to do is the prize for this is for every question that Keith gets right, we're going to Venmo him $1. Ooh, so there's a little bit of money on the line. So, yeah, before we get started, any nerves, anything, any questions, any thoughts?
No, I think I'm ready. We'll see how terribly I do.
He came prepared.
Yeah, he seems to have a lot of knowledge, especially based on his Twitter. So I'm pretty confident. Hopefully I didn't make these too easy. The other thing, the last thing, is after we ask this question, we will, you know, we'll talk about it a little bit. We have some pretty fun stuff in here. So for our very first Twitter fan trivia podcast episode, our first question is, against which team did Devin Booker score 70 points? A, Atlanta Hawks, B, Boston Celtics, C, Cleveland Cavaliers, or D, Dallas Mavericks?
I'm pretty sure that's why Bill Simmons hates Booker, so I'm going to say Boston Celtics.
Yes, ding, 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 that's correct. Okay, so I'm going to write this down so I can remember. But yeah, Devin Booker scored 70 points against the Boston Celtics. What do you remember from this game? Do you remember like where you were and what was going on when you were watching it?
No, I think I was just at home. But I just remember, you know, losing badly and just going to Booker a lot down the stretch. And of course, everybody says that he was just, you know, stat padding and all that type of stuff. So,
yeah. What do you, I know we've talked about this, Chuck, but what do you remember from it?
Oh, I refer to this game as my airport game because I was,
that's right.
I was picking up, and my wife's relative from the airport during the game, and I didn't have streaming capability at the time. I don't know if my connection wasn't good enough, but I remember sitting in the baggage claim, watching his numbers go up, and it was just amazing. Just watching the box score tick up like that was crazy, and I wish I would have been seeing that live. And obviously, I watched it live I watched the whole game in its entirety as soon as I possibly could, and it was an amazing game. And maybe there was some stat padding, but at that point, they couldn't stop him. We were still somewhat in the game. We were competing in a professional sport. I mean, what's wrong with that? But it was a special night.
Yeah, I remember it being special too. I mean, I know we lost. I know there was some stat padding, but 70 is still awesome. I remember I was working. At that point, I worked until, I forget even what time it was. It was like 8 or 9 p.m., but I was living in Iowa at the time, so we were a little bit ahead because of the time zones. So I know I had watched a little bit of the game just like on my phone during breaks and stuff. And we were getting pretty destroyed. But I know I got home around halftime and I was contemplating if I should even turn the game on or not. I did because, you know, it's a as a Suns fan, we have to put up with this stuff.
And you're a glutton for punishment.
Exactly. And I turned it on, and I just couldn't believe what I was seeing. And I know we lost, but in that moment, I didn't care. And I was sitting in my couch, sitting on my couch, and just, like, going nuts, you know? Even though we lost, it was still awesome to see him score 70.
And yeah, we had much else to cheer for the last few years, so it was amazing.
Right, especially that season. That was a rough one.
And something to keep in mind, just going forward, we watch Devin Booker play these teams in the big cities in the Northeast, and he's been tearing it up over his entire career. As of now, Booker's averaging almost 31 points per game, 5 boards and 5 assists against the Celtics, and that's on almost 45% from the floor and almost 43% from downtown.
Jeez.
So he can fire against the Celtics, that's for sure.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Take that, Bill.
That's right, Bill.
All right, let's go to number 2. We're going to throw it back just a little bit here. So, number 2. The Suns played Michael Jordan's Bulls in the 1993 Finals. How many games did the Suns win in this series? A, 0, B, 1, C, 2, or D, 3?
So I believe we lost 4-2, so we won 2 games. Game 7 would have been in Phoenix, I believe.
Yes, that's all correct. Yeah, so ding, 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 another right answer. What do you remember from this series?
The shot at the end of Game 6, breaking our hearts, you know?
Yeah, of course.
And the first win of that series, actually both wins came in Chicago, which is something to say against the Michael Jordan Bulls. But that Game 3 win was a triple overtime win.
Wow.
That sort of split my memory. I saw that on B-Ball Reference today. And triple overtime game in the finals, that's wild. That's worth a rewatch right there.
Yeah. And, you know, with some time that we have, this might be a good rewatchable game. I know the NBA was putting up some more content on YouTube, and I saw a rumor that they were going to make League Pass free.
They did.
Did they actually?
Yeah, okay. I believe you just create an account on NBA.com, and then wherever you do it through there, or like the League Pass app if you download on your Roku or Amazon box or whatever. Apple I'm pretty TV. Sure you just need to create an account with NBA.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, if this game's available, that might be a good one to go back and watch.
Yeah. And like Fox Sports Arizona is showing Suns games and old Diamondbacks games and hockey games. I think they're just showing reruns of everything. So
yeah. Okay. So that could be, hopefully we could see that game. That'd be a good one. Okay. Great. Let's see. Let's go to number 3 then. So, wow, I'm realizing these questions might be too easy. They get a little bit harder though. So, number 3. Which team did the Suns beat most recently before the NBA went on hiatus? A, the Portland Trail Blazers, B, Golden State Warriors, C, Utah Jazz, or D, Milwaukee Bucks?
Well, it's either A or D. I think the Bucks were most recent.
Is that your final answer, D?
Yes.
Okay, yes, you're correct. Ooh. All right, 3 for 3 so far.
Yeah, I have a question here.
Okay, okay.
Why are we so good against the Bucks? Keith, why do you think we're so good against the Bucks? Why do we beat these guys?
Well, you know, DeAndre is the Giannis stopper, I think.
Right. I agree.
Yeah, that's a good point. DeAndre has shut him down, well, as much as you can shut Giannis down, multiple times. And I know the last time we played the Bucks, they were without Giannis, so that definitely helps too. This game feels like it was a year ago.
Yeah,
it really does.
Oh, yeah, it's wild. It's wild. Yeah, this was a fun one, though, because this was a home game, too. I remember... And I know I said this on the show the week or most recently after we had beat them. But Bucks fans were pretty salty, I will say. They were like, oh yeah, well, we've won 50 games. And I said, well, you just lost to the Suns, who have won a certain amount of games that I will not mention because of further trivia questions. But yeah, it was pretty funny to hear all the Snowbird Milwaukee fans complaining about losing to the Suns.
The arena was full of Milwaukee fans. That and the Toronto fans that had been there. I don't know if that just lines up with like a spring break vacation or spring training. I'm not sure how that all lined up, but that was a little disappointing with that many away fans in the arena.
Just the another benefit of living in Phoenix.
We're used to it, though. But
yeah.
It still grinds me. And I feel like our duty as Suns fans when we go to games, we need to make it not fun for opposing fans to be there.
I agree.
Do you agree with that? Or I tell my wife this, and she gets a little upset about it. She says, you don't need to be mean. But I feel like we just give them back what they tried to do in our arena.
Right? Yeah. Well, this is I'm curious.
Listen to me trying to justify myself on my
But I'm curious about what you think about this, Keith, because all three of us come from out of state. So what do you think about that concept?
Oh, definitely. You know, I love seeing the fans get involved. A lot of people actually hated when the fans did that wave in the crowd, but I actually enjoyed it. if I've been to a few games in my life in person, you know, I would be talking the whole time.
Yeah. And that's interesting that you bring that up, because I'm a very public wave disliker, I guess you could say. But I think it's different because I have gone to so many games. You know, we have had season tickets for a while, and it gets, I don't know, sometimes it gets annoying. But I think to see the joy that people have going to their first game, or maybe not even their first if they haven't been to a lot of games, I think sometimes we take that for granted, having the ability to go so often. So maybe I need to relax my stance on that.
We've turned into the grumpy old men that want people to stay in their seats and not block our view. That's literally us now, Mitch.
I know. I still get into it. I still have fun.
Oh yeah, absolutely. It's still a great time, but we've talked about it before. Basketball games, if you're there to just watch basketball, some can argue it's just as good to do on TV. But if you're there for the entertainment factor and you want to go get something fun to eat, maybe have a few drinks, I mean, going to a basketball game is great for that.
That's very true. Yes, yeah. That's true.
Yep.
Okay, let's move to number four here. Okay, who is the Suns' all-time leader in blocks? A, Larry Nance, B, Sean Marion, C, Amari Stoudemire, or D, Alvin Adams?
You know, just because he played the most games, I think it's D, Alvin Adams.
Is that your final answer?
Yes.
Okay, that is incorrect.
No.
The block leader, all-time block leader, is my boy, Larry Nance.
Oh,
I'm a big Nance fan, yeah. Larry Nance, actually, it's not really close either. Nance has 940 blocks as a Sun in his Sun's career. Alvin Adams with 802. And Amari Stoudemire had 722. He's, like, way behind. That really surprised me.
He shouldn't have gone to New York then.
Well, yeah, that too. I agree with that.
We can all get behind that one. And, you know, I think the most impressive guy on this list is Sean Marion as a small forward, being third all-time in blocks with 894. Mm-hmm. The Matrix was so fun to watch. And I've, over the last week or so, I've tried to go watch some more games from the 7 seconds or less era. And I just love, I get fixated on Marion because he's just so dynamic. And that shot for him, you can't not see that.
Yeah, I mean, Marion's one of my all-time favorite players. I remember the first time I saw him play in person. Now, obviously, I was there for Steve Nash. Steve Nash is my all-time favorite player of all time in any sport. But, I mean, Marion, he just has that gravity where the way he plays, you can't help but notice him.
yeah, he was everywhere, you know, and I mean, everything, offense, defense, and I just hope that, you know, Mikal and Kelly can keep playing the way they've done and be similar.
I like that. They need to be watching Sean Marion tape as much as they can. That's a good point.
That sadly reminds me of when I really hoped that Josh Jackson would turn into Sean Marion. There were so many similarities, but the main factor of actually being a dog, I don't think Jackson has that. But, you know, now that we say that, he was playing some decent games for the Grizzlies before the league went on a little hiatus here. So who knows what will happen in that situation. But my second favorite guy on the blocks list, number 8, Alex Len. Who would have thunk it?
Well, yeah, that always surprises me too.
I always liked Alex.
I liked him when he could catch the ball, which wasn't very often.
That was the problem.
He's with the Kings now. I forgot about that little trade that sent him away from Atlanta to the Kings. So, you know, we'll see what happens with him in the future. But the Kings with Rashawn Holmes and Alex Len now.
The Twin Towers. They should probably play both of them at the same time.
Yeah.
Len has been through that. Maybe they should get Tyson Chandler, too. I mean, he's not doing a whole lot for the Rockets.
I don't think so either. He's too tall to play for the Rockets.
Yeah, that's right. How wild would that be if there were 3 mediocre big men from the Suns all on the same team?
I could see it happening. Why not?
Yeah, we've gotten rid of a lot of players, so.
Yes, we have. That, it's actually probably not that crazy because we have had a lot of guys on the team. Okay, let's go to number 5, though. Don't forget about your lifelines either because some of these questions get a little bit tougher. So, number 5. What was Aaron Bane's 3-point percentage thus far through this current 2019-20 NBA season? A, 35.1%, B, 37.2%, C, 33.5%, or D, 32%.
Okay, and this is just for this season?
Just this season.
I'm going to go with A. I believe it's A.
Wow. Yes, it's A. That was amazing.
All right.
Cool. Yeah. Okay. So 35.1. Yeah, he's shooting pretty well from 3. What do you think of Aaron Baines on this team?
Well, you know, for the first 10 or 15 games, it was amazing. Everybody was talking about most improved player and everything. And then he got injured, and when he came back, he just wasn't the same. And then recently he had that 37-38 point explosion.
Yep.
And who knows what would happen if the season continued. But it'll be very interesting to see if we keep him next year or not.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting, too. I mean, he's going to draw some interest from other teams, for sure. We do have some cap space that's going to be interesting. So, you know, we've talked about how it's a weaker free agent market and a somewhat weak draft with a lot of question marks now. So, yeah, maybe a guy like Baines could get some decent money. I don't know. What do you think, Chuck?
I really don't know what's gonna happen with him this offseason. Because when we traded for him, I think it was surprising that he was gonna stay around. I think a lot of people were assuming we'd release him and he'd go to a playoff team. But the thing that I'm really drawn to when I'm just thinking about Baines is how terrible we would have been without him this season.
Ooh, yeah.
Even if DeAndre didn't get suspended for 25 games, Baines is such a big part. And yes, he's been streaky and some games he can't buy a bucket, but he proves that he's you have to worry about him. And when Hassan Whiteside didn't worry about him in that Trailblazer game, he lit him up from downtown. So just the fact of having a true stretch big, I guess I'll wrap it up saying someone's going to give him a decent contract next year. I just don't know if it's going to be us.
Yeah. Yeah. We'll definitely have to see, but I think you're completely right on. Okay, let's go to number six. Devin Booker was an all-star this season. How many points did he score in this year's all-star game? A, 12, B, 20, C, 6, or D, 8?
Well, not nearly as much as he should have, because he didn't get much burn.
Right.
Agreed.
I'm going to go with D8.
Ooh, so close. It was 6.
Ah.
Yeah, that's okay, though. You were really close. 6 points. A little bit disappointing, except he did have the highlight putback dunk that, you know, was going around Twitter. So that's what really counts.
I love the random displays of explosiveness from Devin Booker, like that putback dunk. That was cool, and you'll see him throw down like last year when he dunked on Anthony Davis. That was incredible. He shows that athleticism when it's necessary, but I just like the way he uses it.
For sure. Yeah. What did you think of all the All-Star stuff this season, Keith?
You know, I really liked it, except for the TikTok girls. They need to stay away.
I don't know what that was all about.
I didn't see any of it. I don't even know.
I know what TikTok is, but I don't know the relevance of that dunk attempt.
Yeah, but you know, other than that, the introductions at the beginning and everything were really nice. And it was the first time I'd watched it in years, you know, without any Suns being in it, so.
Yeah. Yeah, that's interesting. You know, the TikTok girls thing, you know where I heard about that from was Zach Lowe. Hearing Zach Lowe talk about them was incredible. It was so funny because he was so confused. He didn't know what any of it was. I have a little bit more knowledge on it than that, but I'm still not well-versed. So pretty funny to hear him talk about that. But
I'm surprised you didn't really do some research on that before he talked about it, honestly.
Yeah, knowing him, he's usually completely on top of all of his research. But I guess TikTok was not his top priority.
Maybe not in the wheelhouse, that's fair.
Yeah. Yeah. The ending, or I guess... Yeah, kind of the ending. The format for the All-Star game itself, you know, with getting to a specific number of points, that was an idea by a guy named Nick Elam. And Amir Blumenfeld, his podcast Buckets, he did an interview with Nick Elam. It's like 25 minutes long. And I really recommend listening to that. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, I thought the Elam ending was great. I loved it. I hope they do it again.
Yeah, I would like to see that again, too.
But watching those guys go hard for that entire fourth quarter is entirely worth it. Watching, just compare that to, like, an NFL Pro Bowl. Those guys can't do anything. Meanwhile, you can play a pretty competitive game of basketball and not worry about getting hurt too badly. I just love that format, and I think... Really, as fans, we deserve to get a game like that, to see the best of the best play each other hard. I think we deserve that.
Yeah, that was like Game 7 NBA Finals there for a while.
It really was.
Well, and I think it's like we've said before, the All-Star game doesn't really have any implication on the season or the playoffs or anything like that. And we've always talked about somehow incentivizing it like they do in baseball. So I think that this was a good way to do that, to incentivize guys to play hard. So, yeah, I think we've pretty much solved that. It worked really well.
Yeah.
Okay, let's go to number 7, though. This is a fun question. I'm excited to see where we go with this one. Sure. Which of the following players did not play for the Phoenix Suns at any point? A, Chase Buttinger. B, Jamal Crawford. C, Danwell House, or D, Wilson Chandler?
Okay. You know, I think I know this, but let's use the remove one wrong answer.
Remove one wrong answer. Okay. One wrong answer. Okay. One of the wrong answers is C, Danuel House. He did play for the Suns.
Yeah, I knew that. So I think it's D, Wilson Chandler.
Yes, that's correct. You got it. Yeah. I threw a couple tough ones on here. Chase Budinger specifically.
Wasn't sure about him.
He was with us for a very, very short stint, and it was pretty bleak. But the blonde volleyball playing Chase Budinger did play for the Suns briefly.
As you said, blonde volleyball playing Chase Budinger, I realized I had nothing more to say about him. you got it all right there.
Yeah, that pretty much sums it up. Former Indiana Pacer as well.
You know what? This is very random. I want to watch a men's volleyball game being played. There's high school boys volleyball?
Yeah.
That's crazy to me. We don't get that in South Dakota.
No, we didn't have that either. You know who you should watch is Gonzaga standout Killian Tilly. He's a good volleyball player, too.
We're going there, huh?
Yeah, always. Go Zags. You're the biggest Zag fan I know besides me. Just kidding. but actually, that's a good question. Keith, do you have a college team that you root for?
Yeah, since I'm originally from West Virginia, I do root for the Mountaineers.
Okay, yeah, good call. Javon Carter being on the team probably helps with that, too.
Amen. Loved when he came to the team. Hope we keep him.
Yeah, yeah, I like what he's done for us.
Okay,
anything else on our friend Chase Budinger? No? Okay. so let's go to number 8 here. This one is, I think, surprisingly tough. I was surprised when I was writing this. Who is the tallest player currently listed on the Suns roster? And I got these heights from ESPN, so they're legit. A, Aaron Baines. B, Frank Kaminsky. C, Cheick Diallo. Or D, DeAndre Ayton.
Well, I'm not sure the lifelines would help me, and I think I might know this because I think I've heard that it's Frank.
Okay, is that your final answer? B?
I'm going to go with Frank, yeah.
Yes, that's correct. It's Frank by an inch. Yeah, Frank Kaminsky is listed at 7 foot, and Ayton is 6'11".
Okay.
Yeah, so pretty close, but yeah, you got it.
And what I'd like to point out about this is, out of those four, Frank Kaminsky by far plays the smallest.
Yeah.
Because Diallo is only 6'8", but he plays like he's 6'10", 6'11".
Yeah.
And Frank, with just being 7 feet tall and never wanting to turn one around and dunk it, that hurts a little bit. But I do miss what Frank brings to the table. The team really has been missing him lately. Really wish we'd see this team at full strength at some point here.
Yeah, he really helped the floor spacing, so we could really use that.
Yeah, he did. And like I said last week, I believe, this hiatus is really positive for a guy like Frank Kaminsky, who needs all the time he can get to heal. So if the league does return sometime in the early to mid-summer, we could see him back on the court. So this bodes pretty well for him.
Yeah, and Kelly.
And Kelly, yeah. Yeah, I wonder, I know the latest update we've gotten from Kelly was when he photoshopped his face onto the sun from the Teletubbies. So would love a real update on his medical status. But I'll take the Kelly Oubre Teletubby sun, I guess, for now.
I'm not going to lie, I saw that tweet and it actually cheered me up. I was in a somewhat foul mood, and then I saw that, and the caption was something along the lines of, in case you need this, and it put a smile on my face, and I chuckled a little bit. It really cheered me up, so thanks, Kelly. That was great, man.
All right, let's move on to number 9 here. Yeah, we're doing pretty good here. So, number 9, where did Steve Nash go to college? A, Gonzaga, B, Santa Clara, C, San Diego, or D, Villanova?
Well, even though you wish it was A, I'm pretty sure...
This guy listens to the show. He's a
Yeah, he knows.
Since I live in Santa Clara, I'm going to have to go with Santa Clara.
Oh, well, I didn't know this when I wrote that. So, yeah, I probably wouldn't have given you that, but whatever. Good job. yeah, Santa Clara surprises people sometimes. Another WCC school. I do wish it were Gonzaga, but we had John Stockton, so it's okay, I guess. What do you guys remember, though, from Nash's early days?
Bleach blonde hair.
No, being a backup, not playing much.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. And sometimes I forget this, but Nash's best years were his 30s. When he came back to the Suns, he was 30 years old. That's pretty amazing to me.
Yeah, he really aged like a fine wine, you know, and if the NBA was like it is now, he probably would have done even better.
Right. Well, and I know a few months ago we had that story about him saying, I should have been shooting 10 threes a game. Yeah, probably. But it's amazing how much things have changed since he was in the league. But like I said, Nash is my all-time favorite player in any sport. And he was just such a joy to watch. The way he passed, the way he ran the whole offense, the quick decision-making. I've never seen anything like it.
No, he's just so fun to watch. If you go back and watch any game that you can on YouTube right now, with Steve Nash playing for the Suns, it's worth your time. And we have Ricky Rubio, who is probably one of the closer passing type point guards that you can maybe hold a candle to Steve Nash with. I don't know if you can even say that, but Ricky has been so nice to watch, and it has to give you some vibes of back in the days when Nash was here.
Oh, for sure. Okay. Let's move on to our last question. Yeah, I think we're just going to stick with 10 because we're doing good here. So, final question, number 10. How many wins do the Suns have so far through the 2019-20 season? A, 26, B, 30, C, 24, or D, 28?
Well, I know it was a big deal when we got to 25, so... I think it's 26, which I think was A.
Yes, that's correct. Wow. So 8 for 10. Really solid. I should have made these questions harder, but that's okay. 26 wins. This is the most wins we've had in quite a while, and we still hopefully have some season remaining. So here's my question, though. What did you think the Suns were going to do this season? How many wins were you predicting before the season started, Keith?
You know, I was really optimistic. I usually am. I'm usually a sucker that way. I thought we would be in the mid to high 30s. I was feeling pretty good.
Okay. Still technically possible. Win 10 more games. That's mid to high 30s. I mean, we were somewhat optimistic. I know I said 30 wins.
I said 28 or 29.
Okay. So, yeah, I mean... I still kind of count this season as a win for us. I think even though it's still only 26 wins, we took such a huge step forward that, you know, next season, that's when I think our expectations are going to go way up because we've set things up somewhat well for next season.
Yeah, you know, we've totally changed the culture. That was the first main thing. I think we've got a good coach now. And just seeing the improvement, especially defensively for Mayton and Bridges, I think we're in a good place.
Yeah, for sure.
Yep, I'm in on all of that. And I think what we need to remind ourselves of, and I mean, me personally, after our 7-4 start, I was shooting for the moon. I thought, we're going to the playoffs, this team's going to be great. But this is an entirely new team that had little to no chemistry heading into this season. There's so many new guys. We're going to be keeping some of those. Some will be replaced even next year. But I think having the Rubio and Ayton connection is probably the biggest deal that we need to keep building on for next season. I think that duo is what will be a difference because Booker will get his, But if we get to watch Rubio and Ayton's pick and roll game grow together, it's going to be quite a dangerous duo next year.
Yeah, definitely. I think it's going to be great. And Ayton having a full season, hopefully, will be really helpful. Booker with some increased confidence from being an all-star and shooting for that again. Cam Johnson with some experience under his belt. Mikhail Bridges really growing. Kelly Oubre being healthy. You know, this we're shaping up to have a good season. We'll be okay. All right, so 8 for 10, only having used one lifeline. I'm super impressed. So awesome job. We will be Venmoing you $8 in the very near future. thank you so much for coming on to do this.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It's been really fun.
Good, I'm glad. Let's see here. Let's move into our non-sports section of the show, though. So we talked about this a little bit before we recorded. And what we settled on is, what's one unique activity that you like to do? We might have some more time to be doing these things. So what's one unique activity you like to do? Whoever wants to start.
I say we let our guests start things off for us.
Well, you know, I'm really boring. I'm a pretty geeky person. I love words. So I actually really love playing word games on my phone. Ooh. And, you know, everyone plays words with friends, but I actually like this other game. It's called Word Chums. And if anyone likes word games, I highly suggest downloading Word Chums. It's really fun.
Interesting. I went through a huge Words with Friends kick. I went through like 3 different iterations of that. So you Word did. Chums. Yeah, I did. I'll have to check that out. Okay, nice.
Maybe we can be Word Chums together and play a few rounds, depending on what the format is. I'm always down for that. I consider myself to be really good at Wheel of Fortune. So I like playing those games too. I dig those.
Neat.
All right, Chuck, what do you have?
Okay, so I think as much as I'd like to say that I'm going to pick up the baritone again and start playing, I'm not going to do that. But I kind of enjoy doing yard work as long as it's not 110 degrees outside. So I did some nice work in the front yard. I consider that a pretty professional looking mow job. So I'd say yard work. I like making my yard look nice. And I, with nothing much else better to do, I'm going to keep doing that.
Your yard always does look nice too.
We got that green grass.
Yeah, you definitely do. Okay, this is really tough for me. I'm trying to think of something I haven't said on the show before, but I don't know if I'm going to think of anything. So I'll just go with something that longtime listeners probably know already, but whatever. I played jazz bass all through high school and college, and I arranged songs and things like that. So every once in a while, I'll just pick up my reel book again and play through some jazz standards. I think that's somewhat unique. People are usually surprised when I tell them that. I actually have a minor in jazz performance, which I use never, but whatever. It was fun. So yeah, I think that's somewhat unique.
Hey, maybe after the show, you could we could hop back on Skype and you could play some dinner music for Natalie and I. What do you think?
I guess it depends how much you're paying me.
Not much.
We'll see. We'll talk about it off
air. $8.
Perfect. All right. Well, that'll be it for today. Keith, again, anything you want to plug at the end here?
No, just, you know, the one of the best podcasts around right here, Sunny in Phoenix. Thanks, guys, for having me.
Thank you. Really appreciate it.
And that's at Sundress Dunks on Twitter. Make sure you give him a follow and give us a follow at Sunny in PHX Pod. That's Twitter and Instagram. Check it out. And we appreciate you guys tuning in. We're gonna keep doing some of this trivia stuff. We're going to keep it fun. We're going to keep it somewhat Suns related. But we're going to be coming through with an episode every week. And, you know, this is petty of me, but I just need to tell the guys at the All Fantasy Everything podcast that we, too, are a podcast. putting out episodes. You're not the only podcast. You're not even the only South Dakota born podcaster doing a podcast right now that moved west. I mean, we can break it down as far as we want. We're still doing this thing. Tune in next week. Go Suns.
Clouds below.